Hello, my name is David, and welcome to the first of many behind-the-scenes videos I'll be making covering my Dinosauria series. The Dinosauria series isn't just a series of animated short films. I've been treating this like a very large, multimedia, creative, and educational adventure. I've been doing research, writing notes, doing drawings, and making large clay sculptures for each of these films, all compiled into one big sketchbook. The animated short films might be the end result, but there is so much more to these projects that you guys haven't seen yet. So let's get started. Most of you watching this video probably know me from my Autodale animated series, and my recent experiences with those films are the reason the Dinosauria series exists. The Autodale films are becoming far too large and far too complicated for me to continue working on them to the standard that I was. Working on the most recent film in the series, Immortal Machine, was a particularly bad experience for me and I had to take a break. I wasn't in a good place, and to remind myself that animation was still something I wanted to do, I knew I needed to go back to basics, I needed to start a new film, and make it about dinosaurs, because they are my favourite things in the world. The Dinosauria series got off to a bit of a rocky start though. As you can see, the first page in my sketchbook does not say Old Buck in the top left corner, it says All Days. Old Buck is all the way on page 13. All Days was going to be a very different film from what the Dinosauria series became. It was going to be a surreal, gritty, post-apocalyptic, dialogueless survival story about a group of human beings trying to survive an encounter with a Tyrannosaurus Rex. The film was set on an Earth that was recovering from some unnatural anomaly, where all days happened at once. And after this mysterious science fiction cataclysm, the world is in ruins. It is now a patchwork broken planet where all eras of Earth's history have been blended together, all meshing into one giant, unstable mega ecosystem of survival of the fittest across all time. This frankly bizarre setting was never really going to be the focus though, it was just going to be the backdrop to some fun, creative, man versus prehistoric beast set pieces. I really liked this idea, I even started thinking of making All Days into a series itself, each revealing just a little bit more about that mysterious cataclysm that caused all of this. I was heavily inspired by the work of stop-motion animator and special effects titan Ray Harryhausen for this project. Ray Harryhausen's one of my favourite people. I've seen all of his films and I recently got to see a lot of his stop-motion models in person in Edinburgh, which for a cinephile, dino-obsessed animator like myself, was a pretty heckin' magical experience. I got really, really close to making this film. I finished the sketchbook, I finished maybe half of the assets I required, I finished half the set, even going as far as doing some unfinished test animation based on some of my concept sketches. But after all of this work and research and drawing, I started to realize that this project was getting just as complicated and difficult and stressful as the Autodale series that I was putting on hold for being too complicated and difficult and stressful. I needed to make a film that was easier and simpler with minimal stress, something that was fun. Which finally brings us to page 13. I decided to make a simple film about two dinosaurs having a fight, and what inspired me to make this film about Styracosaurus albertensis over any other dinosaur was a very specific specimen that was described last year, UALVP55900, or Hannah. Hannah is an amazing Styracosaurus. Her skull is asymmetrical, the left side of her frill having more horns than her right, likely due to some injury during her development, and this, alongside a bunch of other recent ceratopsian research, has brought up a lot of questions about dinosaur genus and species classification. Take Styracosaurus ovatus, also known as Rubiosaurus, for example. The main thing that made ovatus different from albertensis was its frill horn orientation, facing more inward than albertensis. But if albertensis can now have as much frill horn variation as an asymmetrical animal, how can we say for sure that ovatus isn't just another example of albertensis with inward facing horns? That's the question that's been brought up recently, and at the moment, ovatus has been merged with albertensis as perhaps a juvenile or a female or an extreme morph of that species. My film following the extreme morph logic. Fellow dino-crazed maniacs may have noticed that the main character in this film, the old buck, himself is based on ovatus, his reveal shot proudly displaying his inward-facing horns. It was around about this time that David Silva's Beast of the Mesozoic ceratopsian figures started coming out. This is an action figure line of scientifically accurate dinosaurs, and I'm a big fan of them. I mention this because I bought these Styracosaurus figures specifically because I was working on this film, and having a highly posable model of the exact species I was going to animate in my hand proved surprisingly invaluable to the making of this film. With this figure, I could easily test out poses and camera angles without time-consuming storyboards or previs or test animation. These stripes on the animal in the finished film are actually a direct reference to this toy. I of course also discovered that you could get two of these toys together and test out some fighting moves. I legitimately choreographed the entire fight scene in this film, playing with these toys.
Stumpy, 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 stumpy.
For those of you who follow my work, you'll know that I often make sculptures to accompany my animations, and I wanted to do the same thing here. I, of course, decided to sculpt a Styracosaurus. For most of the year, in Scotland, where I live, it's below 10 degrees Celsius and raining, but in spring, when I sculpted this, it can get to a lovely 20 degrees, so I could do a lot of the work in my garden, which is probably one of my favourite things to do. This strange, fat, fluffy creature often joins me as well. I began my sculpture without an armature. Instead, I made a bunch of clay sausages in the shape of vague dino body parts, and once they were dry, I glued them all together in a vaguely ceratopsian shape, and then added more and more clay to bulk out the general shape of a Styracosaurus, getting the anatomy and musculature blocked out. For the surface detail, I used pre-made texture plates to make sheets of scaly skin to drape over the model, hiding the seams between each patch with pre-made texture stamps. Wrinkles and scars and all the other surface details are made with a multitude of different tools, but this one is my favourite. I'm pretty certain we don't have any skin impressions from Styracosaurus itself, but we do have skin impressions of Centrosaurus, which is a close enough relative. Centrosaurus has a rather typical ceratopsian scale pattern on its upper body. Uniform, smaller, round scales surrounded by semi-evenly spaced, less common, larger scales. A bit like this, and a bit like this. I'm not sure where this comes from, but most of my ceratopsian toys have square-shaped crocodilian-looking scales on their undersides, so I copied that for my model as well. For painting, I spray-painted the model with a grey primer and used acrylic paints and brushes to mimic the colour scheme seen in the animated short film, with a mostly grey body, lighter stripes, and pink highlights. And, as per usual, while waiting for the paint to dry between coats, I highly recommend serenading the sculpture.
That's life, and I can't deny it.
That right there is the secret ingredient. I'm quite chuffed with this piece. I sculpt dinosaurs all the time. I mean, I've been doing it since I was a kid, but I feel I often default to exaggerating details and features because, well, because subtlety and realism is hard. This model, with its finer and more subtle skin details and realistic anatomy, really makes this guy feel alive to me in a way that my other dinosaur sculptures just kinda don't. He's one of my favourites so far. Absolutely rocking that pink eyeshadow, and of course, having an asymmetrical frill as well. Old Buck tells the story of a Styracosaurus, the alpha male in either a small herd or a small chunk of a mega herd. The Old Buck rests under a tree high above, a dominant, vigilant position. Twigs and foliage from the tree litter his frill like a crown, indicating that he's held this position for a very, very long time. A rival male enters the scene and tries to assert his dominance over the group, bullying a younger male and challenging the Old Buck. The outcome of this fight is foreshadowed the moment that this film starts. When the Old Buck is resting high above his herd, his body is shown to be covered in scars and his nasal horn is badly chipped. Over the course of the film, you get to see the kinds of actions that led to these injuries. Numerous rakings have scarred his sides and numerous stabbings have chipped his horn. He has done this many, many times before. The finale of this film shows the Old Buck return to his post, utterly exhausted and with a fresh collection of scars, still vigilant over his herd but growing weaker and weaker. This animated short film, and the whole Dinosauria series, is 3D animation, but I use a mix of 2D and 3D elements. I use a mix of Blender and Photoshop to achieve the look. Take this shot for example. I start with the 3D character models, which have been textured to look as 2D as I can possibly make them look. I make a simple mock-up of the scene, and I animate that shot in Blender. I then paint the background and the foreground elements in Photoshop and drag them into the scene as well. Finally, I add whatever extra 2D animated elements are required on top. All of this is technically still in 3D space. Each shot looks a little something like this if you move the camera too much. The colour schemes of my short films are an aspect I care a lot about. Colour is a fantastic mood-setting and storytelling tool that in the animation medium specifically can be an incredible asset. The colour scheme of this film is a monochrome greyscale with red and pink highlights and a subtle baby blue added to the sky for a bit of contrast. This is quite stylized, it's not realistic. But I think the mostly grayscale colour palette with the red highlights reflects the primal, brutal, animalistic nature of this territorial fight between two prehistoric beasts really well. This film takes place in Alberta, Canada, 75 million years ago. The star of this film, and the first animal featured, is the centrosaurine ceratopsid Styracosaurus albertensis. I wanted to create a decent amount of logical variation among my herd of Styracosaurus. We have five total unique models, a male, a female, a juvenile, the young buck, and the old buck. Putting all of the males together, the generic male, the younger buck, and the old buck next to each other, you can see a gradual increase in the boldness of the white stripes across the animal's back and horns as they age and become more sexually mature. the youngest individual having the least amount of stripes and the oldest individual having the most, stripes that the juveniles and the females do not have at all. The old buck's frill is also pink, and in one of my favourite details of the film, the females and the other males do not have this pink accent at all, but all of the juveniles do. This subtly indicates that the old buck is indeed the dominant breeding male here. These are his kids because they have his colours. As mentioned earlier, the old buck is loosely based on Rubiosaurus as a reference to Styracosaurus ovatus becoming one with Albertensis. But perhaps a more interesting paleontological Easter egg is with the young buck. You may have already noticed this, but the young buck has an extra horn on his left side, and that's because I based him on that asymmetrical specimen that I mentioned earlier, Hannah. Hannah had two healed injuries to the left side of her frill that were likely the cause of her asymmetry. So, I made sure to add a visible pathology to the left side of the young buck's frill as well, a fun reference to the very fossil that inspired this film in the first place. The second of the three species featured in this film is the hadrosaur Lambiosaurus lambi. Now, Lambiosaurus only appears in like 6 shots and could have easily been cut from the film, with almost no change to the narrative whatsoever, but I really like dinosaurs, and Lambiosaurus is one of my favourite dinosaurs, so I had to put him in. This film takes place during the mating season, and the Lambiosaurus featured are a mating pair. I decided to depict the animal as sexually dimorphic to show this, with the male having a larger crest and the female having a smaller one. Displetosaurus taurosus is a tyrannosaur, and it's the third and final animal featured in the film, even though I accidentally wrote horneri in my sketchbook. Even though the animal only appears for like 10 seconds, I still tried to cram as many paleontological Easter eggs in there as I could. To start with, my model has some facial scars, a reference to the numerous bite marks we find on many tyrannosaur skulls, likely inflicted by other tyrannosaurs. I also decided to give my Displetosaurus lips. Now, lips or no lips on theropod dinosaurs, and specifically tyrannosaurs, is a very controversial topic among the dino community, and Displetosaurus is kinda at the heart of this debate, with a pretty infamous paper published in 2017 which myself and many others aren't very convinced by. I personally think that lipped theropods is the slightly more accurate depiction at the moment, but either is fine. And finally, tyrannosaurs living in social groups is something that's been debated for a very long time, and again, Displetosaurus is kind of at the heart of this debate, because a bone bed was found in Montana preserving 3 individual Displetosaurus of different ages that were all feeding on hadrosaurs at the same time when they died. It's unclear as to whether or not this truly represents pack behaviour, or whether the individuals were totally unrelated and just gathered to take advantage of the same feast. In reference to this discovery, in my film, I made sure to have 3 Displetosaurus gather on the top of that hill, and I tried to keep it vague as to whether or not this is representing a social group, or 3 totally unrelated animals, all taking advantage of the same situation. I've talked about some of the paleontological bits and bobs that went into my creative decisions working on this film, but I'm not totally sure if I'd call this film particularly scientifically accurate as a whole. It's extremely hard to balance creative storytelling drama with real-life scientific fact. Those two things, more often than not, are at complete odds with each other. These films are fictional short films at the end of the day. They are not documentaries. I would like them to be, but they're not. They still have to have characters, conflict, a story, and a moral. They have to be dramatized to an extent. But I feel this film ended up a little bit too dramatized. I think the animals in this film are depicted as a little bit too intelligent and a bit too humanized. There is also no evidence to suggest that Styracosaurus had big violent fights like this at all, and the nature of the fight itself just seems far too over the top and violent to me. Easily, my biggest problem with this film is the shock horror sudden impaling at the end. I don't think this film is bad, at all. I think it looks decent, it's animated well, I think it's a well-paced film, with a beginning, a satisfying escalation, and an end and a point. But this film was conceived and choreographed by smashing two dinosaur toys together, and to me, it certainly shows. I'm sure, as I've showed with the research, the 3D models, the sculpture, the sketchbook, a lot of time and love still went into this project. I really enjoyed making this, and even though I'm not particularly proud of the finished film, I certainly look back at the experience with very pleasant feelings, which was the goal that I set out with. This film is extremely close to my dear old heart. Before this, I was working for months and months on a project that I hated, and I was seriously considering stopping. But this simple, fun dinosaur film reminded me that I still enjoy this. I mean, it was wonderful researching, feeling inspired, drawing, sculpting, and animating something I love again. In fact, I enjoyed working on Old Bucks so much that it grew into a whole creative entity of its own. It spawned this entire series, becoming the first of 5 animated short films so far. And trust me, this is easily the weakest of the series in my opinion. The films just get better and better from here. If you want to support me or read through the sketchbook I've been showing off in this video, you can. The sketchbook has just been uploaded to my Patreon page. You also gain access to updates on the Dinosauria series and gain early access to each of my animated short films 2 weeks before they're released here on YouTube. Probably unsurprisingly, this was the most fun I've had making a behind the scenes video in years. But, I mean, I knew that was going to happen. I was looking forward to this. I love talking about dinosaurs. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to go outside and film some B-roll for the outro. I'll be looking for, the most interesting tree I can find. Special thanks to all my top Patreon supporters on screen right now, hopefully scrolling over some footage of a cool tree. I could not have made this series without these people. You guys have supported me through some extremely important healing months of my life, and I really cannot thank you enough for that. But I can give you this tree. Eh?